We're going to talk about, so first lecture was about free groups, right, and a little bit about hyperbolic groups. Like yesterday we spoke about Van Kampen diagrams and Cayley complexes and then function. Now today I am going to talk about subgroups of free group and different different nice properties of free groups, like residual finiteness and so on. So these properties are basically, I mean, when people try to study negatively curved groups, they try to generalize, to find these properties in the other groups, in the larger classes of groups, or find something similar to these properties. So this is like whatever role model for which properties should be satisfied in like a negatively curved group. Okay, so, and again, Stalling's graph is going to be used in our proofs. So again, so if you have a subgroup of a free group, we know that every subgroup of a free group is free, right? Because it's a fundamental group of a graph, of a cover of a graph. And but now we're going to do a little bit more. We are going to compute the basis of a subgroup. If you have a finite number of generators, if H is finitely generated, we are going to compute its basis. So how to do this? So first we have to construct the Stalling's graph, which is a part of the Schreier graph of H. And so it consists of all the loops, maximal subgraph containing all the loops beginning at H. So, and we also, like, we consider it also as an automaton, as a finite automaton, which accepts the language, which is exactly our subgroup H, like the set of all reduced words, which is our subgroup H. So this is, again, this is an example for H generated by these three elements. So we can read A, B, A, then A inverse B square, and then what is this? A, B, A inverse B, right? So, okay, now let me give you some terminology so that we are on the same page about graphs, because I am actually going to talk about graphs a bit. So, okay, two vertices are adjacent if there is an H joining these two vertices. Now a path, okay, it's a sequence of edges such that terminal vertex of HI is the same as initial vertex of HI plus one. So it's what is a path intuitively. Then a path is simple if beginnings of all edges are distinct. So it's like not self-intersecting. A path is a loop if beginning and terminal vertices are the same. And we also can talk about a simple loop, right? So it's a loop which is a simple path. A path is reduced if we if we don't do this. So it's EI and then go back. So it's reduced if EI plus one is not the same as EI inverse. Okay, then a graph is connected if there is a path between any two vertices. Right? A graph is a forest if it doesn't have simple loops. So it doesn't have to be connected. So a graph is a tree if it is a connected forest. So actually a forest is a union of trees, as expected, but it can be an empty forest too. Okay, now this is a simple exercise. You'll do it as an exercise that in a tree there is a unique path joining every two vertices. No. A forest doesn't have a loop. A forest, if it doesn't have simple loops, then it doesn't have loops, okay, because every loop is a composition of simple loops. Right.
Thank you.
Okay, so, okay, this unique path is called the geodesic between U and V, the unique path joining U and V in the tree. Now, okay, every connected graph has a maximal subtree. So what is a maximal subtree? It's also it's called a spanning subtree. So it is a it is a subtree, so it's a tree which contains all vertices of the graph. Right? The tree which contains all vertices of the graph. Like a subgraph, which is a tree and contains all vertices of the graph. You can say that it is what? It is a, if the graph is connected, then it is a maximal union of edges which doesn't have a loop, right? Or like, So every connected graph has a maximal subtree. Like for a finite graph, this is very easy like to do. You just what? You take a vertex, like add an edge, and then you keep adding edges so that you don't have a loop. And when, like every time you either can add an edge without adding a loop, if you cannot, then it is a maximal subtree. So definitely like there is an algorithm to do this for a finite graph. Okay, also in the Stalling's graph of the group, a path is a sequence of edges, like in the exponents plus or minus one. And the path is reduced if it does not have any subpath like this. Okay, we know that the subgroup H corresponds to labels of loops beginning at this vertex V node corresponding to H in this graph. So, okay, so how do we find a basis for a subgroup H? So first we construct, I'll do a proof by example. So first we construct a Stalling's graph. So if we have this subgroup generated by these four elements, so this will be the Stalling's graph, and this is our distinguished vertex H, like V node. Okay, now choose a maximal subtree. Arbitrarily, like, so red edges represent a maximal subtree, right? You can see that it contains all the vertices, and like if we add one more edge, we are going to have a loop. So red edges represent a maximal subtree. Also, denote by GV, G sub V, the unique geodesic from V node to V in the tree. So in this, like, it's a unique red geodesic. For example, V node is here. So suppose V is this vertex, right? Then GV, it is this path, okay? Now, actually, the rank of our group is going to be the number of edges that did not get in this tree. So the number of simple loops. So take some edge, oops, sorry. Take some edge which belong to, which is positively oriented. I mean, we denote like there are actually two edges here, right? So one is positively oriented, another one is negative orientation. Take a positively oriented edge from the graph which is not in the tree, okay? And set this element SE to be the label, okay, lambda. Did they have lambda before? So lambda is a labeling. Lambda is a mapping from the alphabet to the set of edges, to the set of actually positively oriented edges. If you have like alphabet AB, set of positively oriented edges. And inverses are labels of edges read in the other direction. Okay, so what is SE? It's a label. For example, take this edge. Then, it is positively oriented. So we have to read the label of the geodesic going to the beginning of this edge in the tree, so AB. Then we have to read the label of this edge, B. And then we have to read the label of the geodesic going from this vertex back to H. Right? So it's going to be AB, B, A. Okay? And the claim is that actually, I mean, these elements SE for edges which do not belong to the tree, they form the basis of H. So this is a free generating set of H. And we are going to, whatever, I'm going to give a hint of the proof. But let me ask you, what's going to be, like we can form such an element not only for edges which are not in the tree. What if this edge were in the tree? What would be the element? For example, take this edge in the tree. So we go to the beginning, then read this edge, and then we have to go back using unique geodesic in the tree. So what do we get? Let's see. Go to the beginning. We're considering this edge, which is in the tree. Identity, right. Yes, excellent. So we get an identity, right? For every edge which is in the tree, like this element SE is going to be the identity. So, okay, now, okay, so the claim is that the set of all these elements for edges not in the tree generates H, the subgroup H, and that they are actually free generators, so there are no relations between them. Okay, so first we'll show that what we'll show that they all together. So if we add elements for edges which are in the tree, that the set all together generates the group. But we already know that elements which are in the tree, like this SE, are actually going to be equal to 1. So let's see. So this is how we form it. This is we already know. Okay, so this set forms a free basis. Okay, so take a word W in H. So since the automaton, since the Stallings graph accepts W, there exists a reduced loop at V0. Reduced loop, so we don't go back along the edges, right? Reduced loop at V0, so like this, E1, E2, EN, such that the label of this loop is our word W, okay? Okay, but we can write this loop like this. So so first of all, E1, the initial vertex of E1, it is our vertex V0, right? Because we begin, let me just draw it. Unfortunately, one cannot have slides, two slides. So this is W, this is V0, which corresponds to H. So we have E1, E2, something like 3, E4. These are our edges. Maybe like this. Okay. So, like, the geodesic to the initial vertex of E1 is an empty path, right? So we have, but we can formally write it like as G. U1, then this H, and then we go back. Then we come here, we read this H, and go back along the, again, we have to make a tree, probably. Maximum is a tree. Then we go here, read this H, and go back along the geodesic. Then we go here, read this H, and again, they go back along this geodesic. Then we go here, read this H, and go back along the geodesics. So actually, we can represent like this path can be written as a composition of these loops, right? So composition of these loops. But then, okay. And this is a proof, like this is our path, like the composition of these edges. It can be represented like this, it can be represented like that, and it can be represented as a composition of these loops. So the label of this path is a product of the labels of these loops, right? So the product of this path is a product of the labels of these elements as E for all the edges in the path. Mm-hmm.
Considering you can go either way on it, and it would be the same.
No, we choose edges with positive orientation, right? Oh, okay. So basically, yeah, so we come here to the initial point, then here, and then we have to go back along the geodesic, so we have to. It's actually a trivial element. Mm-hmm.
I'm confused with what your alpha and your tau are.
Alpha is the beginning vertex of the edge, and tau is the terminal vertex of the edge. Okay, so basically what I'm saying, we can represent each loop as a composition of like these loops corresponding to elements S E, like this. So composition of this, so this product of these edges, it is actually a composition of these loops. Okay, now then this means that the W is actually the product of the labels of this loop, so it's a product of SE, elements SEI, and we know that SEI is equal to identity when the edge belongs to the tree. So it is a product of these elements for edges which do not belong to the tree. And I write E plus because I'm talking about positively oriented edges. Okay. So now, okay, so this is a generating set. Why it is a basis? So what we have to show, that like we have to show that if you multiply any two elements like from the generating set, then so that there is no reduced word in these elements SE which represents the identity element, right? Like reduced word in the elements from SE, it is actually a word in a free group, right? So that every reduced word in elements SE is actually a reduced word in a free group after we make possible cancellation. But like if we take the product of two elements for edges not in the tree, then let's look at the path then. The corresponding path, I just don't put labels here, we just can look at the path. In the corresponding path, what we have? These edges here are edges from the tree, and edges here are edges from the tree too, right? So we can cancel some of them, probably. But EU1 is not in the tree. So EU1 cannot be canceled with any of the edges here. And EU1 is not the same as E2 inverse, so E2, it cannot be any cancellation between, it can be cancellation, but EU1 and E2 survive in all the cancellations. So this means that if we write the word in this, like we write a path corresponding to the word in SE, so these edges are going to survive all the cancellations. And then we make labels, okay, the labels too going to survive because these were like reduced words. So, okay, so this is a basis then. And there is an algorithm to find this basis. So basically, if you have a subgroup given by some finite number of generators in a free group, there is an algorithm to find the basis for the subgroup. It's not unique because the tree was not uniquely chosen. Like you can choose the tree different ways. But like you can find the basis, you can find the rank. And like again, example. So suppose we have a free group given by two generators, subgroup given by this. Generated by these three elements. So this is a Stallings graph, A, B, A inverse, B inverse, A, B, what's it? It is B square, A, B inverse, and B, A, B, A, B inverse. Okay, so this is a maximal subtree. So what is the rank of this group? Two, right? There are two edges which are dotted in the tree, so two simple loops. We can write the generators. So it's very easy. Like, it's basically like children game. Okay. Now this is actually was probably a Gulnara exercise, right? Like this question. So let's talk about this. So the graph is complete if for any vertex and for any generator there exists an H labeled by S and S inverse from V. So that if the degree of each vertex is 2 times the number of generators, right? The graph is complete. And the theorem is that if you have a finitely generated subgroup of a free group, then it has finite rank if and only if the Stallings graph is complete. So if the Stallings graph is complete. And in this case, actually, finite index, the index of H is exactly the number of vertices in the Stallings graph. In this case, the Stallings graph is the same as the Schreier graph for this subgroup, as the graph of cosets for this subgroup. So how do we prove this? Okay, so first, if it is complete, okay, then it is a Schreier graph, right? So gamma zero, if you remember, this is a Schreier graph. If it is complete, then it is a Schreier graph. So then the group has finite index, the subgroup has finite index. Because, I mean, every coset representative, why it is a Schreier graph? You take a coset with some coset representative, like take some whatever, A1, A2 inverse, A3 H, right? And then take this, our vertex H. I mean, the graph is complete. So there is a H labeled by A1 from H, right? So we have this coset HA1. The graph is complete, so there is an H labeled by A2 inverse. I mean, there is an incoming like H, like this, from H A1, A2. Okay, the graph is complete, so there is an H labeled by A3 from here. A3, so we have H, A1, A2, inverse A3. I mean, we can find every right coset of H in this Stallings graph. And so therefore, Stallings graph is the same as a Schreier graph. Okay? So this is in one direction. Now, in the other direction. Okay. The group is finitely generated. So what we have to show? We have to show that the Stallings graph is complete, right? No, we know that if it is complete, then it has finite index. Now the subgroup is finitely generated, and it has finite index, right? We have to show that the Stallings graph is actually complete. But then, I mean, if you basically, again, we have to prove that the Stallings graph is actually the same as the Schreier graph in this case, right? Because it is finitely generated. So if we so H is finitely generated, if it has finite index, so there is a finite number of cosets all together, right? And so this means that if you take a path like to some coset, we have to form a loop initially, right? Because we cannot go to infinity. There is only finite number of cosets. So every such path is the beginning of a loop ending at H. You probably proved it yourself yesterday, right?
We were drawing the same thing.
But it is important, yes. But it is important that H is finitely generated, because you cannot, it was a good example, like the graph of the derived subgroup in the free group. Nastya asked, the graph of the derived subgroup of a free group, right? Stallings graph. It's the commutator of a free group is infinitely generated. Good exercise to prove. And if you can try to construct a Stallings graph for it, it's going to be the same as a Schreier graph. And so it's complete, but it doesn't have a finite index. So it's only true for a finitely generated subgroup. Okay. So far we can solve some nice questions. So we can, if you have a subgroup, we can construct Stallings graph, we can find the index if it is finite or infinite. And also the number of elements in the basis of H, or like rank of H. It is actually number of edges minus number of vertices plus one in the Stallings graph. Because if it is for the tree, again, do it as an exercise. For the tree, edges minus vertices plus one is zero, right? So this is basically, we compute how many more edges the graph has. And we can decide if an element belongs to the group. So we have just to read it here, and I think this particular word doesn't belong. So the element belongs to the subgroup, if and only if we can read it as a loop in this graph, beginning with V naught. Okay, so let me just skip this. It's solution to this problem, but we are already very wise. So I would like to talk about some other properties of free groups. So one of the properties is going to be residual finiteness, and we'll prove actually even nicer things. We'll prove that a free group is a subgroup of SL2Z, and a finite index subgroup of SL2Z. So for that we need a so-called ping-pong lemma. Okay, so let group G, generated by two elements A and B, act on a set. So there are undergraduate students here. Do you know what means group acts on a set? So mapping from product group set into set, satisfying like associativity property for group and identity element acts as an identity mapping on the set. So the group acts on a set, and assume that there are two non-empty subsets, A and B. So the intersection is empty, and A to the A and B belongs to A, so when we act by any power of A on elements in B, we get into A, and when we act by any power of element B to the elements in A, we get into B. Okay? Then G is freely generated by these elements A and B. Okay? Now, how to prove this?
Can you give a picture? I mean, I remember there's an action on the circle.
It's not even really how to give a picture. So we have A, we have B, so this trivial intersection, right? So B to the any power moves A here, and A to any like action of A moves B back here, right? And then, okay. So what we have to show that this the group subgroup generated by A and B is a free group. Equivalently, we have to take a reduced word in A and B and to show that it is a non-trivial element, right? That every reduced word, arbitrary reduced word, is a non-trivial element, reduced word in A and B. So let's take this reduced word in A and B. And first of all, we can assume that it begins and ends, begins with A and ends with A. If not, we can conjugate it by some big power of A. If we conjugate like non-trivial word, we have non-trivial word, right? If we conjugate trivial word, we have trivial word. So now, suppose W is, what is like what I wrote there? We have, W is A to the N of 1, B to the M of 1, and so on. So it begins with some power of A and ends with some power of A. Now, let's apply this W to B. Let's act to B by W. So what we have? A to the NK takes B to A, right? Then this application of this B takes A to B. And so on. So we're basically going like this away, this away, this away, this away. And we end, since our word begins with A to the N, we end up here. Right? Okay, so what we have that if we act on B by W, we got an element in A. So it cannot be a trivial mapping because A and B are. Because A and B are not intersecting. Questions?
I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
Why can we assume W begins and ends with the A plus or minus 1?
I mean, take some word and multiply it by A, conjugate it by A to the power million. Like, then it will begin with A, maybe 2 million, like big power of A, so that you don't have like all the constellations are done. Then it will begin with a to the power, like million minus something maybe, and ends with a inverse to the power million or something. Unless this word is a to some big power, right? Or to some power, you have, I mean, you have a word beginning and ending with a, even if it is a power of a. Because then it also begins and ends with a itself. Okay, so this is a ping-pong lemma, and now let's look at these two matrices in SL2Z. So SL2Z, group of integer invertible matrices with determinant 1. So let's look at these two matrices. And I'm going to apply ping-pong lemma to show that this subgroup is a free group, actually, on two generators. Okay, so let's take two sets. So G is subgroup, basically to Z generated by two matrices. Now the set X is going to be the set of column vectors in R2, column vectors in R2. Okay, and then our set A, it's going to be a set of all vectors, X, Y, such that the absolute value of X less than the absolute value of Y. Okay, and B, for B we have vectors such that absolute value of X is greater than absolute value of Y. So these are two non-intersecting sets, right? Okay, then let's check that we have this, property that if you multiply B by any power of A, now we're going to, so let's multiply, okay, first A by X, Y, A is a matrix 1, 2, 0, 1, so we have X plus 2, Y, and, Y, right? And actually, if you multiply it to power n, we're going to have what? We're going to have x plus 2n times y, right? X plus 2n y. I mean, it's easy to see that the absolute value of the first component here is going to be larger, like for any non-zero n, it's going to be larger than the absolute value of the second component. So this is in B. Right, so we have like a to the n, a belongs to b. And similarly, you can show that b to the n, like b to the n b, belongs to a. So by the ping-pong lemma, we have that this is a free subgroup. Okay, and now what we can do from here, what a nice thing. So it is a linear group. A group is linear if it is a subgroup of a group of matrices over some field, actually. Like instead of Z, we could take a field, a Q or whatever, R. So it's a linear group. Actually, every free group of countable rank is linear because as an exercise, what you're going to prove as an exercise today, you're going to prove that a free group of countable rank, or like any finite rank, is a subgroup of a free group of rank 2. So the okay, so basically like for any exercise, for any n, Fn is a subgroup of F2, free group of rank n is a subgroup of a free group of rank 2. And even like infinitely generated free group. So here the analogy with vector spaces is like fails. Like subspace of a vector space of dimension n has dimension less or equal than n. And for free groups, it's not true. We can put free groups of any rank inside free group of rank 2. I mean, this is a little bit more advanced than like to do it whatever in half an hour, probably. Prove that this subgroup generated by these two matrices is called Sanov subgroup, that it has index 12 in SL2Z. So basically SL2Z is what we call virtually free, right? So it has a free subgroup of finite index. It is virtually free. And I mean, maybe you can prove it faster, but I believe one needs an hour to, at least an hour to think about this. But maybe I'm slow, like maybe you can do it faster. Okay, and then one very important property of free groups. So just general definition, a group is called residually finite. If for any non-trivial element, G, the group, there exists a homomorphism into a finite group, so that the image of this element is non-trivial. Okay, so every group is residually finite if you can map this group. For every element, you can have a mapping into a finite group so that this image of the element is non-trivial. Equivalently, again, to prove as an exercise, if for every element there is a finite index a subgroup such that it does not belong to this finite index subgroup. I mean, this means that there is a normal subgroup of finite index, right? That the element does not belong to some normal subgroup of finite index. Equivalently, right, it does not belong to a subgroup of finite index. It proves that it is equivalent. So actually, okay, certainly like finite groups are residually finite because they are finite themselves, right? Now, how to prove that this, SL2Z is residually finite? Again, you can do it as an exercise, but the hint is, so we have integers, right? So we have matrices. Take a non-trivial element. It is some matrix. And then take a prime number P, which is larger than all the entries in this matrix. And factor like Z over like P times Z. Then you have what? You have a group of, you have a SL2N over a finite field. And it is a finite group. And this element is mapped to the non-trivial element. And you can convince yourself that this is true. So a free group is a subgroup of SL2Z, right? So subgroups of residually finite groups are certainly also residually finite because the same mapping works. So free groups are residually finite. Group of not residually finite. Some Baumslag solitaire groups. Exercise. Exercise. Like Baumslag solitaire group B23. Like I think this is okay. B. Okay, 2, 3. So it's what A B. B minus 3, right, this relation. It's not residually finite. Actually, residually finite groups are, I can talk a lot about residually finite groups. Again, exercise. Maltsev invented this once, that every residually finite group, every finitely generated residually finite group has a solvable word problem. Right, so how to solve word problem if your group is finitely generated, recursively presented, certainly, I mean, the set of relations is recursive. How to solve the word problem in such a group? Now we need, actually, we're going to talk about other properties, so-called subgroup separability property of finitely generated subgroups of a free group. Subgroup separability means, okay, that every finitely generated subgroup is, again, so has a finite index subgroup such that it does not belong to the finite index subgroup. So it's, let me just show you, okay. So finitely generated subgroup is equal to the intersection of finite index subgroup containing it. Okay, another definition for every finite index that for a finitely generated subgroup, and element which is not in this subgroup, there is a homomorphism to a free group such that the image of the element does not belong to the image of the subgroup equivalently. So like residual finiteness, but now in residual finiteness, we would like to separate the element from the identity in the finite quotient. And here, we would like to separate the element from the subgroup which does not contain this element in the finite quotient. Okay? So this is what subgroup separability is. But for this, so we are going to prove that every finitely generated, that actually free group is subgroup separable. Every finitely generated subgroup of a free group is separable. But like in this theorem, which we'll prove for this, we have a notion of a free product. So I'll give you a definition of a free product. Okay, so if we have a free product, it is something like a free group itself is a free product of cyclic group generated by basis elements. It can be considered as a free product of cyclic group generated by basis elements. In general, so what is a free product? We have a family of groups. Assume that like we take mutually disjoint sets for this family, take a union of all these mutually disjoint sets, and identity element being element one element set disjoint from like this union. Now a word is a finite string where each letter belongs to this union, of these groups. Now, a word is reduced if none of this, no AI is an identity in its group. For all I, AI and I plus one are not in the same group. And if AK is equal to one, then, so if you get to one, then all the elements like further than one are also trivial. And the free product is a set of reduced words in this alphabet. So they form a group, and then the operation is juxtaposition, then cancellation, like reduction, and contraction. So for example, if we have if elements AI and BI belongs to GI, suppose we have like G1 and G2, take a free product, then how we multiply these two? So this is a reduced word, and this is a reduced word. When we multiply them, we cancel. And then A2, B2 belongs to the same group, so we replace it by their product. And then like, B1, B3. Okay, now this is a wonderful theorem of Marshall-Hall, which actually will imply separability of finitely generated subgroups of a free group. So, let H be a finitely generated subgroup of a free group. Take an element G such that G does not belong to H. Then there exists a finitely generated subgroup K of F of X such that, if you take a subgroup generated by H and K, it is a free product of H and K, this L. L has finite index in the free group, and the element G does not belong to L. So basically, what we do, we find G does not belong to H. We find a finite index subgroup L such that G does not belong to L, right? But in addition, we have more knowledge about L. So H is a like a free factor of L. So L can be written as a free product of H and something else. Okay, so again, like the element did not belong to a subgroup H. We find the finite index subgroup L, so that element does not belong to this finite index subgroup. But this L is actually a free product of H and some other subgroup, some other finitely generated subgroup. Okay, so this is what we're going to do. Again, prove by example. So suppose this is a Stallings graph of H. Right, so H is let's say A square B A square B minus 2, right? Okay, and take an element BA. This we cannot read it in this Stallings graph, so it does not belong to this subgroup. Let's nevertheless draw it here, like in the picture. So as far as we can go along the graph, we go along the graph, but then it like it goes outside of this graph because it is not in the subgroup. Okay, now we have this picture. So this is this is our BA. Now what we would like to do, we would like to complete this graph. So arbitrarily, we would like it's not a complete graph. If it is a complete graph, but it cannot be a complete graph because we went outside of this graph, right? There is a vertex of degree 1. So we have to complete it arbitrarily, just throwing in edges labeled by some letters so that we have a complete graph with this set of vertices. Like, why can we do this? Because the number of vertices, so take edge labeled by A, the number of vertices such that A is an outgoing edge is the same as the number of vertices it is incoming, right? So if it's not enough A's, okay, take two arbitrary vertices, which one which does not have outgoing A, one doesn't have incoming edge. So the number of such vertices is the same. So we always can like draw an edge. Again, so the number of vertices such that have the number of initial vertices of edges labeled by A is the same as the number of terminal vertices. So we always can, for each vertex which does not have outgoing A, we can draw this edge labeled by A, and we have where to the other vertex where we can go. So we can complete this graph arbitrarily to a complete graph. So this is that, for example, on the picture. You see every vertex has degree 4 now, right? So what do we have? We have this is a Stallings graph of the subgroup L, so it is a subgroup of finite index, right? And the element does not belong to the subgroup because, we did not make any, whatever, we did not do anything to the element. It did not, when we read this element from the element G from the initial vertex, we don't come back to the initial vertex and we did not change this property. Okay, so this is a Stallings graph of the subgroup L. And what is left, just to show that this subgroup L is actually a direct product of our subgroup H and something else, some other group, right? But what we have here, we have loops corresponding to subgroup H. So we can, let's do the following thing. Select the maximal subtree the following way. So first we select the maximal subtree for this first graph, for the graph of H, right? And then we extend it to a maximal subtree of graph for L, okay? And then, again, the exercise, but what I am claiming, then if we select the basis, like this element SE, as we did, so part of the basis going to be elements, generators of H, and then some other elements. But then it is a free product of H and the group generated by all the other elements, right? So that's the proof. It's not how Marshall Hall proved it. it's basically Stallings who invented such pictures. Okay, now and then this implies that free group of finite rank is subgroup separable, so every finitely generated subgroup H of F is equal to the intersection of finite index subgroups containing H. What we actually prove that for every finite index subgroup and every element not in this subgroup, right? There is a for every subgroup, finitely generated subgroup H, and for every element not in this subgroup, there is a finite index subgroup which does not contain this element, right? It's equivalent to this formulation. Okay, now this is a non-trivial property of free groups. And the next slide actually You don't have to understand all what is written here. Just subgroup separability was one of the properties of so-called virtually special hyperbolic groups. Like a few years ago, Jan Nagel proved a so-called virtual hacking conjecture. And like three last problems in the Thurston geometrization program. And I think there was a program last year here, right? Institute for Advanced Studies about this. So it was like a big, big splash in mathematics. It was a statement about hyperbolic tree manifolds. So they have a finite sheeted covers, which are hacking manifolds. And again, I'm not defining these terms. You always can Google this or whatever. Probably Agal's lectures were taped here. So it's interesting. But I mean, the whole proof is actually geometric group theory proof. Because what he actually proved that, so if you have a hyperbolic group, you know what it is, which acts properly and co-compactly on a cut zero cube complex. Okay, cut zero cube complex, basically you just add cubes of different dimensions nicely to one another. In this case, we say that the group is cubulated. Then it has a finite index subgroup, so that like this quotient is a special cube complex. Okay, in this case, we say that the group is virtually special. I mean, I won't tell you what is special. Okay, so it has some nice properties. Now, co-compactly means that the quotient is compact. Properly means that pre-image of a compact is a compact for this map. So it's standard nice action. Now, the proof actually begins with the work of Haglund and Weiss on special cube complexes. And which implies that this virtually special hyperbolic groups, first of all, they are linear groups, and you know what linear are now, right? And that they are quasi-convex. I'll define what quasi-convex subgroups tomorrow. Quasi-convex subgroups are separable. So it's basically what this means, that special hyperbolic groups, they have this nice property of free groups. They are in a sense, they are like groups with some properties of negative curvature, right? And so they have this nice property of free groups, but not for all the finitely generated subgroups, but for so-called quasi-convex subgroups. That's one of the ways like how properties of a free group, can be generalized. So this is just to mention about separability. Okay, now what we have? So let's talk about intersection. Basically, the question is, so we have two subgroups, H and K, of a free group, finitely generated. How to find the basis for their intersection? Okay, so we have Stalling's graphs for both of them. How to find the Stalling's graph for the intersection? And the answer will be that the Stalling's graph for the intersection is a product of Stalling's graph for subgroups. But we have to define what is a product graph. So, okay, suppose we have gamma and delta, two directed graphs. So the product graph is defined as follows. So the vertex set is a set of pairs of vertices, so one in gamma, one in delta. And we draw an edge. So we draw an edge between one pair and the other pair. We have u, vu, and v prime, u prime. So we draw an edge labeled by some letter x if and only if there is an edge labeled by x from v to v prime in the first graph, and there is an edge labeled by x from u to u prime in the second graph. So only in this case we add an edge labeled by x. Okay, so this is a product graph. Now, it's certainly also directed graph. So the lemma is that if you have Stalling's graph for finitely generated subgroups H and K, Then, and H is a language accepted by the first graph starting with vertex V. V is vertex corresponding to H. And K is a language accepted by the second graph beginning with vertex U, this vertex U, initial and terminal vertex. And take this vertex in the vertex set of the product graph. Then this graph is folded. Folded, I mean, it has one-way reading property. There are no two edges labeled by the same letter from the same vertex. But I mean, certainly it is folded. How can it be unfolded? We draw an edge only if, like, there are edges here, and those graphs are folded. So it have a folded, it is a folded graph. And the language which it accepts is exactly the intersection of the subgroups. So let's just think about this. So, right, we start in this pair of vertices. When we draw an edge labeled by some letter, if and only if, it, like in both graphs we can do this, right? And then again, so every edge we can draw in both graphs. So what we accept, the language is the intersection of languages of both graphs. And so it's kind of, and also like everything what we can read in both graphs. So it is exactly the intersection. It's now this is an example. So, okay, we have these two subgroups. So this is H. What is the vertex? This bold vertex is the initial vertex. So we can read what? B, A, B inverse. Green edges are B, red edges are A, and we can read B square. And this is a graph for K. We can read A square, and we can read B, A square, B. Okay? Now, this is the intersection. Let's see. I mean, how many vertices should the intersection have? This has two vertices and this four. Eight, right? Eight vertices, so each pair of vertices should be there. Now, let's just see. So, for example, this path. This, we have green path from this vertex in both graph, right here and here, green. And then we have red from both, and then we have another red in both of them, and then we have back. But the okay, so the claim is that so the vertex which corresponds to this pair of vertices is this bold one, right? So this is the intersection. B A square B inverse. It's a cyclic group generated by B A square B inverse. Okay, then what like this graph is disconnected, as you can see, right? This graph is disconnected. It's going to be the exercise again. What are the other components? What do the other components correspond to? What are they? I mean, it should be something. Some of them are just don't have any vertex. So it's just a vertex, right? There are no any edges. This probably corresponds to what? To some empty intersection of, but of what? Of which subgroups? I mean, this graph corresponds to intersection H and K. Like, what are the other ones? What do the other ones, other connected components represent? You probably, whatever, you have to think about this a little bit. But this is like, I mean, this is a 15 minutes. Or maybe you can answer now. Some people know, probably. And then another exercise is going to be, I'm stopping here. How do we see if a subgroup is normal? Suppose H is like, H is a finitely generated subgroup. How can we see from the Stalling's graph that it is a normal subgroup? So basically the N minus one exercise number N minus one is what are the other connected components here, and exercise number N is like, how do you see the normal subgroup? So that's all for today, and next time we talk about like elementary properties of hyperbolic groups tomorrow. Okay, thank you.